So good morning. We're going to talk to Dr. Eric Kurlander, Professor of History and Director of Jewish Studies, Stetson University Department of Chemistry this morning. And while we're involved in this conversation, hope to have an opportunity to really bring to life some of the pretty fascinating work that he's done over the years in his tenure at Stetson. And before we begin, I would just like to say good morning again, Eric. We've worked together for close to two decades.
At least. I think we came in together in 2001 or two or whenever that was.
2001. Right. So, and you've been a constant production of scholarly work. And I'm just curious, how did you become interested in history? More specifically, how did you become interested in the area of scholarship that you pursue today?
Good question. Thank you, Harry. And I just want to say it's a pleasure to talk to you about research mutually, because so much of our interactions over the years have had to do with curriculum or administration. So it's really, it's fun to talk to one of my longtime colleagues about our scholarly work. I thought, and this will be maybe news to you, but also interesting given your career path. I thought I was going to go to University of Illinois for engineering my senior year of high school. I really liked history, but I hadn't yet thought about doing history teaching or doing history seriously at the time. And at the last minute, I kind of applied to a couple liberal arts colleges. And one of them, Bowdoin College, where I ended up going for undergraduate. The first class I took was a class in change and revolution in Europe with a professor named John Carl. And I enjoyed that class so much more than some of my other classes. They were all fine, but I really enjoyed that class. I recalled how much I'd enjoyed history over the years. And I think it's that class, my first year of college, where I started to think about possibly teaching or doing something related to history. But it wasn't really till my senior thesis, which is related to the project we'll eventually talk about today, which was called Two Faces of Inferno, Two Faces of Removal, looking at the duality of the Nazi Jewish question, that I started to think, you know what, I wouldn't mind going to graduate school in history and not doing something related to, you know, law or finance or many of the things that my colleagues were doing. So it was kind of a process. And end of high school, I thought I was going to be in the sciences. And then beginning of college, I started to get more interested in history. And that's when I chose my major, I think. And then by senior year doing that senior thesis, I thought, you know, maybe graduate school would be fun. So it was a process, I think.
Interesting. It's always telling when we look back, especially as we proceed, you know, along our careers and reflect back and think about some of the initiating events, right, that set us out on a path that we didn't necessarily think we'd be taking. That's interesting. Thank you for sharing that.
And great teaching with John Carl. If I had had a class I didn't enjoy, I don't know that I would have pursued history as a career.
Okay. So I've noticed over the years, as you have posted about your travels to do your research to the various countries, and would you consider yourself a polyglot? Do you have reasonable fluency in multiple languages?
I have some proficiency in German and less in French, and I'm starting to be able to discern some Polish because of my partner's native tongue. But actually, I would say compared to my colleagues in history, my language skills are rather modest. It's essential to do not just European, but now more global and comparative history, that you pick up the languages well enough to read archival sources. And once you commit to doing that, you end up studying in those countries. So to give you an example, I had only taken French and not very much of it when I went to college. And then it was only at the end when I started to think about grad school that I took a year of German. So I went to graduate school with only a year of German and maybe the equivalent of 2 years of French. And I learned it on the job. I learned it by, you know, first taking a German for reading knowledge. I passed my language exams. And then you go into the field and you're reading all these archival documents, but then you start meeting people, you start using the language. So I would say I learned to use the language as I learned very much as a tool. And then only organically did I start to learn to speak them and try to, you know, watch movies and really be more immersed in the culture, which is kind of the reverse of what many people do. They'll major in a language in college, take some intensive language courses, and then they go to graduate school. Mm-hmm. So I actually feel that compared to many of my colleagues, my language skills are modest at best. But I suppose for someone in a field where language isn't as essential, right? It used to be, right? In chemistry, until World War II, you had to take German.
German or Russian.
German or Russian, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's part of the job description to be a historian these days.
Well, thank you. I asked that question because I imagine it's an essential tool, you know? And I think sometimes we lose perspective and appreciation because it's everyone speaks English, right? Or everyone reads English. And it's not the only language. And even if you're not, you know, fluent, a native speaker, I do believe that there is a, you know, it's important to have an appreciation, and at least if one can appreciate the written word of other cultures. So thanks. And with that,
yeah,
now we can begin to talk about the good stuff, right? So your most recent, or the evolution of your research, would you like to talk about that?
Sure. So I think like most academics, you pick your research question based on what the pressing issues are or pressing questions are at the time you're developing your new projects, right? So when I was in graduate school in the mid-90s, we were coming out of a period of massive transformation in the way we approached German and Central European history. Going into the 1980s, the general approach is, why was Germany different than other countries? So why didn't Germany, with all its great scientists and poets and intellectuals and universities, why didn't it follow a more liberal democratic path, implicitly or explicitly, like Britain, France, the United States? A lot of this came out of modernization theory, which was big in the social sciences in the 60s and 70s, the idea that there are different paths to modernization. The appropriate one was the Anglo-Saxon model, where you have a revolution led by middle-class liberals, and that's usually less violent and more kind of sustainable. The French sort of did that, but not quite as well. And then as you move east, right, Germany, Russia, China, they tried to modernize, but ended up being very top-down, very authoritarian, very bloody, lots of mass deaths. So this was a kind of theory among liberal social scientists, Barrington Moore and others in the 60s and 70s. And that very much defined the questions in my field going into the 1980s. And then a group of young British historians, most of whom were Marxist in inflection, including my advisor at the time, a guy named David Blackburn, in the late 70s and 80s started to say, you know, this is not only empirically problematic that we keep looking at Germany as if it was completely different or vastly different in certain areas than these other countries it was interacting with. And, you know, the royal families were connected. Germany was modernizing in much the same way as the United States, had a north-south divide, had all these other, they said it's empirically problematic and it's theoretically problematic to claim some countries are peculiar or backwards and others aren't, right? And that was kind of the dominant paradigm going into the 1990s. And I, doing all my reading in graduate school, thought, you know what, this is a very convincing paradigm, But how do you explain then the big differences, right? You can only normalize every history, which they all have their own particular paths, so much before you can explain why they take the different paths. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So my first book, which I finished while I was at Stetson in the early 2000s, based on my dissertation, is called The Price of Exclusion, Ethnicity, National Identity, and Decline of German Liberalism, was saying, okay, if Germany is very modern and in many ways is liberal and as democratic as other Central and West European countries, why do you get this, not just fascism as a solution to the crises of the 1920s and 30s, but a radically racist version of fascism, which seems much more obsessed with questions of racial purity, ethnicity, than let's say Italian fascism or Franco, if you want to call Spanish fascism, fascism. So that was my question. And my conclusion is, even liberals in Germany, and I have colleagues now who have said this about the Socialist Party, were preoccupied by questions of race and space and identity in ways that that would sound to, you know, Western liberals a little less universalist, right? Mm-hmm. Not that Western liberals were all universalists. Look at colonialism, look at what happened with, you know, slavery, Native Americans. But when it came to other white Europeans, the obsession with race in Germany did look somewhat different. I mean, the way they looked at Slavic peoples or Jews, and the fact that this was a preoccupation among liberals, I said that might help explain why so many middle-class voters that had traditionally voted liberal, when you get economic crisis and depression and the instability of the Weimar Republic, so many of them moved to the far right instead of the moderate left.
That's like a classic aggrieved position. People are feeling threatened with regard to their position in a society. Age old, interesting.
So that's the first book, and it came out of my immersion in these big shifting debates in my field. Then the next book, the one that became Living with Hitler, Liberal Democrats in the Third Reich, I mean, superficially, it looks like it's just an extension of the first, because I'm still looking at liberals, and now I'm looking at them after 1933, after the Nazis come to power, instead of before. But it was really quite different in the questions I was asking and in the methodology, because I was no longer comparing election returns and why liberals succeeded or failed and what their political culture and propaganda might look like in different regions. I was looking at the leaders of the Liberal Democratic Party. These are the people who either had already been or would be the presidents of Germany, the greatest intellectuals, the greatest writers, many of whom clustered in the Liberal Democratic Party. We're talking about Theodor Heuss, Gertrude Bäumer, the leading feminist, Albert Einstein, right? Mm-hmm. And I was saying, how did they negotiate being in one of the most radical fascist regimes in history? Because most of them, with the exception of some of the ones who were Jewish and a few that were on the left wing of the party, didn't leave. And even at the time, and certainly as I worked on it, the question I was thinking about is, how do liberal Democrats make peace with authoritarian moments, right? Because what was happening in 2001, 2, 3, 4, I saw much of the Liberal Democratic Party in America acceding to the Patriot Act, Iraq resolution, supporting these imperialist wars that even at the time, for most historians, like, why is Iraq suddenly a threat? It wasn't a threat for 12 years. They don't have connections to Al-Qaeda. And you're starting to see liberals make these concessions, rationalizing it for practical reasons. They feel pressure, you know, in the wake of 9/11, you had to be patriotic. So clearly that was at the root of my question. And it was no longer about why is Germany different, really. It's what can we learn from Germany about liberal Democrats encountering a unstable and then authoritarian kind of wave in the 1930s, and learn about why liberal Democrats now in the United States, maybe Britain and what parts of Western Europe, are making these concessions. Now, that wasn't my explicit question. It really was still embedded in the historiography on German liberalism and how liberal were they, and what were their attitudes towards foreign policy, gender, race, right, biopolitics. But that was part of it, right? I was, my question was coming out of the climate we were in. And my conclusions were the Liberal Democrats really did try to split the difference between making too many ideological concessions, because they weren't fascist, right?
Right.
And remaining viable politically, socially, culturally, and economically.
A form of pragmatism?
A form of pragmatism mixed with ideology. I mean, so whether you're a liberal historian, a Marxist historian, or even many conservative historians, some of whom liked that book because they didn't really read it accurately, there is a tradition in progressive liberalism that seems to overlap with aspects of fascism, right? For the Marxists, it's the capitalist part, right? They're all capitalists and they all want to preserve bourgeois individualism and private property. For conservatives, I'm talking about traditional ones who would claim to be Christian and ethical, they see the preoccupation with remaking the world through science and eugenics as a progressive liberal project, right? And ignoring what people on the ground want. So whether you're on the left or the right, people were interested in that book because they saw ways of saying, well, where can liberalism go wrong? Where does liberalism make too many compromises? Why does it seem to lose out to authoritarianism in Germany and elsewhere? So that was my second book. And then the last one was again influenced by contemporary questions, right? It's Hitler's Monsters, Supernatural History of the Third Reich. And that was very much a response. I mean, I came up with the project partly based on interest going back to graduate school. I'd always been interested in why is there this fascination with the occult and Nazism? You know, where does that really come from? How much of that is based in history or not? I had a colleague in graduate school who wrote a book on occultism in Germany, and the last chapter did touch on the Third Reich. But I think what really motivated me, besides already being a full professor and realizing I could now be more experimental in the questions I chose, right? It turned out to be a very solid academic book, but you never know what's going to happen. So it came out of looking at the Tea Party, Sarah Palin, the beginnings of what we now know as QAnon or alt-right movements in Europe and America, and saying, how can people claim things like the Democratic Party is running a child prostitution ring out of a pizza parlor and get votes, right?
Right.
How can conspiracy theories and occult thinking about, you know, space lasers run by the Rothschilds, you know, so that we used to associate with far-right conspiracy theories in the interwar period and say, well, of course, liberal democracies in the West are somehow immune to that. And then you're seeing that start to happen on one side of the political spectrum. And I want to be very careful here to say that in the 20s and 30s, it was the Democrats who were open to these ideas, right? The Klan almost took over the Democratic National Convention. So it's not a Democrat-Republican thing. You might call it a left-right thing or a focused alt-right populism thing, but clearly that was starting to happen. And so I wanted to now, for sound empirical reasons also, say, how did that work in the 20s and 30s? Was there a conscious effort on the part of the far right and the Nazis to instrumentalize or operationalize these occult, pagan, alternative religious, mythological, and what I call border scientific beliefs to get voters and to basically pursue certain policies of race and space, right?
You know. So it's interesting. From a layperson's perspective, given the importance of supernatural or spiritual types of beliefs, especially I'll just say in Europe, you know, Celticism, all the, you know, do you think through your work, there's you uncovered any evidence to support that the occult or focusing on these religious supernatural aspects really tapped into some cultural stock of belief in the supernatural?
Well, so first of all, that makes sense.
In
doing this research and also reading some of the sociology of religion and political science on conspiracism and other things, it's pretty clear that Weber was right, that the late 19th century, early 20th century was an era of disenchantment, right? Okay. The disenchantment of the world. There was just too much science and too much technology for the average person who was paying attention to have full recourse to traditional religion and use that as a way of explaining the world. Everyone was at least subconsciously aware that religion was based on faith alone, right? That's one way of putting it. But since many human beings can't operate that way, Weber's theory is they're searching for new kinds of spirituality or things they can, in which they can put their faith.
Right.
That may tangible. Not be Lutheranism or traditional Catholicism, but speak to the same yearning, the longing for myth, as my colleague George Williams
said. Okay.
And then the question is, how does that get deployed? So my argument is that in some countries in Europe, in the United States back then, you had the same phenomena, but because of a certain stability and commitment to liberal democracy that was fairly strong at the time, it remained privatized. So you had seances, you had Aleister Crowley in Great Britain, and people were fascinated by it. You had science fiction and comic books, emerge in the 20s and 30s where people fantasized about these alternative worlds, hollow earth theory, world ice theory, but they remained privatized. What I mean is you were in your drawing room conducting a seance at a party, but you didn't start drawing from those theories, theosophy, anthroposophy, actual ideologies about how the world worked or how science and religion could be integrated. And what you're seeing in Germany at the time, I would argue because of the rapid modernization, the confronting modernity in such an extreme way between the 1890s and 1920s, and then the world wars, is a recourse to some of those ideas as if they actually have a valence in helping you explain the world. It's not a place you go to get away from the world, the way we would watch Marvel movies or right. Tolkien or read Harry Potter. It was actually being integrated into theories about how the soul and spirituality and the body and biology operate. And when you combine that with the fact that a lot of these mythological, paganist, border scientific and occult ideas had racial theories attached, because everyone in the late 19th century was speculating about race, social Darwinism, lesser. Right. It becomes a very dangerous cocktail where in a crisis situation, people start to resort to those ideas as an easier way to explain the problems and contradictions of modernity. So since the 1890s, I'd say they wax and wane based on the context. And I would not say that currently Germany is our biggest laboratory for looking at this right now. The Germans, having gone through that process, might be a little better insulated against a far right party that makes, more blatant recourse to folkish ideology, paganism, bizarre scientific theories about Jews or other races. Actually, if we look at Europe right now, it's France, it's Scandinavia, it's the United States, possibly Great Britain, where some of these ideas don't have the same guardrails.
Italy. Right?
And they always have different manifestations. It's not what I call the supernatural imaginary, this kind of amorphous group of ideas that are arrayed against materialism and empirical science and boring social scientific method, right? And the boring, horse trading of parliamentary democracy. That reservoir of ideas will vary in content from time to time and place to place, but it serves the same function. And so what you're seeing now is a new kind of supernatural imaginary. I think in America today, it's a little more overtly Christian than it was in Germany in the 20s and 30s because of a stronger pagan, Nordic, folkish tradition there. But you can see that the kind of Christianity it draws on is not really embedded in the doctrine of the Catholic Church or even traditional Lutheranism. It's still something you can play with. You can tie to bizarre theories about race or aliens or ancient aliens. So yeah, I mean, that's a longer answer you're probably looking for, but it waxes and wanes, much like anti-Semitism and racism in general. It's always there as a reservoir of kind of xenophobia. Right. But when times are good and both parties seem to be establishment parties, the racists just pick a party and kind of hold their nose and they vote for them. But when things get really unstable, if one of the parties, whether it was the Democrats, you know, before World War II or the Republicans after World War II, decides they're going to play on those fears, you can collect a reservoir, what I call the fascist third. Mm. I would say about a third of every modern industrialized society, which now would also include Japan, right, and Korea, are by proclivity authoritarian, fascist, whatever you want to call it. They really aren't thrilled with the processes that are supposedly the norm of interacting with people who have different points of view, compromising with their representatives politically, living with the outcomes, believing that regardless of race, gender, and sexuality, we all are more or less the same. If you push these people, they know not to say that openly. They don't really believe that. So when they're given a vehicle to coalesce those ideas of authoritarianism, one-party state, xenophobia, believing in white nationalism or whatever it might be in other countries, some form of ethnic nationalism, they're all too happy and finally actually get more enthusiastic about politics because they're frustrated by the George Bushes of the world and the Hillary Clintons and the boring establishment, let's talk about how we're all on the same team kind of rhetoric. So what becomes dangerous is when the socioeconomic situation, the foreign policy situation are in flux or crisis, and these groups get, whether it's the Democrats, Republicans in our country, get collected in one party, and that third of society, which has these authoritarian proclivities, can now determine elections, or at least all the primaries. And then you get a situation where one party or the other may not embrace certain liberal, democratic, and pluralist approaches to the world, scientific, empirical, right? That you need to have a functioning liberal democracy.
So that's basically the definition, right, of weaponization.
Yes.
You know, and comparatively speaking today, with all the technology, with all the social, you know, the amplification of social platforms, social media, it's really a powerful, powerful tool that can be used to get people in power and keep power. If you were to compare Nazi Germany in the early 30s up through World War II with today's representatives, shall I say, what would you say would be some of the most surprising similarities just in terms of how the Nazis, say, wielded that influence, weaponized that?
I got a perfect analogy for you. Yeah. And okay. It fits chronologically, and this will also provide a bridge to the current project, the summer grant project. Most people now agree. Remember, I talked about this revisionist trend in the 80s and 90s, moving away from the idea that Germany was different than all these other industrialized countries. Most people agree that the really big turning point wasn't, you know, the Teutonic Knights, the Middle Ages, or, you know, the Germans in the Roman time coming down as barbarians with this different culture. It wasn't Frederick the Great. It wasn't even Bismarck. It was the 1890s, as I already mentioned. Before the 1890s, the conservative and to some degree the liberal parties could, in local elections, selectively play on antagonisms to Catholics, Poles, and Jews to get votes. And then they'd go back to governing in a more moderate centrist way, right? One of Bismarck's best friends was a Jewish banker named Bleichroeder. So, but he understood he had to make certain concessions to colonialism, racism, anti-Semitism, or the conservative and national liberal parties did And then they could go back to governing in a more informed, pragmatic way. Most people agree that around the 1890s, this strategy started to backfire. The people that had been consuming these ideas about racism, xenophobia, the Jews control all the banks and all the, you know, and our high rates if you want to get a loan as a farmer, that the Poles are taking your jobs, that the Catholics aren't really German because they listen to Rome. They're starting to run in their own parties. At the time, they were called the anti-Semitic parties. Most of them were right, far right parties with anti-Semitic leaders. And for a brief period in the 1890s, they did quite well at the polls and then kind of faded again. But you now had this kind of dry run where the conservative and liberal elites, who didn't really believe this stuff, but were playing sorcerer's apprentice, saw what might happen if those people break with them and form their own parties, right? And then guess what happens in the 20s and 30s? That's what they do. They say, we don't like the traditional conservative. Yeah, they say some anti-Semitic things, they're nationalist. They always vote for the military. They always support an aggressive foreign policy, but they don't really speak to us. They don't seem serious about it. And that's where you get a dozen far-right movements, which ultimately morph into the Nazi movement.
It's a foothold.
If you look at the United States and you look at Nixon's Southern strategy, right? Goldwater was getting, and the Republicans were getting crushed through the mid-1960s. Why? Because the Democrats finally said between the 30s and the 60s, if we represent all poor people and all lower middle class people, regardless of region, state, or color, we can win every election. Because who wouldn't want better welfare, unions, shorter work days, better education, less poverty, right? So if they ignored the racist Southern Democratic wing and said, we're going to help you, but we're not going to let you define our candidates. We're also going to support civil rights and immigrants, right? It undermined the Republicans, who had always been getting the vote, for example, of African-Americans because of the Lincoln. And were seen as a party of civil rights well into the mid-20th century. So Nixon's brilliant idea with Roger Ailes, who would go on to found the news division of Fox, right? The late 60s, early 70s, is what if we can appeal to those disillusioned Democrats just long enough to get elected and then govern in a responsible way, right? It's called the Southern strategy, because we could then win elections and then do the right thing once we're in power. And if you look at what the Republicans did from Nixon through Gingrich, let's say, they might go to the South Carolina and talk about states' rights and make and endorse Jesse Helms, being very uncomfortable with it, right? But then when they got to Washington, they'd govern in more responsible ways. Sometimes they'd break with their party. It's what you see happening in Germany between the 1890s and 1920s. But they're playing sorcerer's apprentice to this right-wing populism, the same way the Democrats did before World War II, right? Then you get the 90s, Gingrich, right? Pat Buchanan, then more kind of international crisis terrorism. You get Palin. And all of a sudden, the people who were just supposed to vote and then go back home to their uncomfortable lives, now that they'd voted Republican, now they're running for office. Now they're demanding their own candidates who aren't establishment. No one wants to vote for Jeb Bush or Charlie Crist or Mitt Romney anymore. And all of a sudden, they start to take over the party, because we are in a two-party system. So you want the analogy, it's if you play sorcerer's apprentice to these forces long enough and you allow them to get an identity and coalesce over 20, 30, 40 years through the media, through every election, you ramp up their frustrations, their xenophobia, eventually they might break with the establishment and now they start running things. You saw that in Germany between this was a dress rehearsal for fascism between the 1890s and 1920s. Everyone said they'll never get 30% of the vote. Don't worry. Look at what they're saying. And then in 1930, they get 17%. And in 1932, they get 37%. And now all of a sudden, they're the largest party. Never a majority. They never got more than a third. Remember that. Doesn't take much more than a third to screw up a democracy. So how does that get to my current project? The current project, again,
perfect segue,
is looking at Germany and not just Germany now, it's really all of Europe and really all of the industrialized world as a laboratory for understanding the Jewish question, right? The Jewish question.
I'm sorry, you did this in France this past summer?
So the summer grant was supporting research in Britain. But with the Brown Center link, but I was in Israel before that at Yad Vashem and the Israeli National Library and on a Fulbright, and the earlier stages of Fulbright were in France and Poland, which gives you a sense of the globe. And I was in Shanghai a few years ago with the support of a summer grant, because what I'm looking at is how did the Jewish question as a problem to be solved, right, get deployed, discussed, how were solutions proposed before 1941, when the Holocaust, most people would say the Holocaust begins, the final solution begins, and how similar or different were the ways it was discussed within Germany and outside of Germany, between liberals, conservatives, socialist Jews themselves, and the fascists or Nazis, right? How different were these conversations about this so-called Jewish question? And it has two pieces, right? On the one hand, obviously, I'm looking for when the Jewish question becomes radicalized in a way that may seem distinct, where you can start to say, the answers these people are giving are so different than the answers these other people are giving. You can see the beginnings of ethnic cleansing or genocide. You can see how it could go in that direction. On the other hand, I want to see the ways that countries that never went down that road were still using similar language, talking about similar solutions, which is helpful in a couple different respects. One, it says that it didn't have to go down the road of the road of the final solution. Had other countries taken seriously the problems they themselves have been talking about, and it wasn't just with Jews, right? Whether it's the Turks with the Armenians, or whether you're talking about the Roman Sinti there, or the Polish question, there were a lot of white European bourgeois liberal conservative leaders of European countries talking about these questions like a problem to be solved. What do we do with these ethnic minorities, these refugees, right? The women question, right? Holly Case has a whole book about the 19th century invention of questions, right? Which is usually, they're usually invented by white male, middle-class Europeans. But she implies at the end, and I think many would, basing this on Foucault, a lot of good evidence, right? That they usually lead to more disciplining and punishing and potentially even genocide, right? The more you talk about a group as a problem or a question. And what I'm seeing, and kind of my hypothesis is, while it's never a good thing to separate a group out as a problem, there are other directions that it could go in, including Palestine, right? It's the most famous one. The Jewish state started to be founded before 1941. The woman question did end up with suffrage, women's suffrage. It was solved by giving women equal rights. Poland got a state. So we can't assume that when those discussions start, they always lead in a more radicalized Foucauldian way towards a loss of rights or murder. And if we take that more open-ended, non-teleological approach, we can say, where were the turning points, not just among the Nazis, but other groups where other interlocutors, where the Jewish question went from being a problem to be solved in these ways, whether legally or territorially Jews would get their own state, to the only logical solution for the Nazis is mass murder. And if we understand that, we might be able to better understand how these other questions that no one looks at in the early stages as potentially genocidal could go in that direction, but could also go in an alternative direction. Does that make sense?
Makes perfect sense. I mean, vilifying a people most often ends up in a worst case scenario. And I think it's interesting that you are focusing on potential alternatives. So it's a multi, which
both means to understand where it ends up, how it gets to that final solution, but but also what were the alternative paths and what can we learn from that in intervening in these kinds of conversations earlier with greater alacrity. And of course, the assumption behind all of this is the best possible world would be one where it's so cosmopolitan, pluralist, and inclusive, no one even uses that language, or you never have groups defined by their ethnicity, sexuality, gender as a problem. But given that that hasn't happened and doesn't look like it's going to happen anytime soon, I think the more responsible approach is say, when that starts to happen, what are the likely outcomes? Why do otherwise liberal states seem to be abetting these problems for a time? Where can they intervene earlier? What are we missing in these processes? And again, this is part of taking something that's usually outside of history, the Holocaust, which in my field at this point, very few historians anymore see it as outside of the larger history of colonialism, capitalism, right? Biopolitics, but it's still taught in a way which is paradoxical, whether it's in American schools or in certain kind of intro college classes, is this almost singular kind of reverse mythological event that, you know, it's so terrible. How could we comprehend it? How could these Germans do this to these innocent victims? And that makes it something you can't study empirically and you can't learn from, because if it's outside of history, an almost mythological event that could never be repeated because it's so terrible, then what's the point of studying it, right? But if you embed it back into its actual antecedents and you see how similar these discussions were to discussions about Jews and other groups at the same time, you can start to parse out where do these questions start to become radicalized in a way that can lead to ethnic cleansing and genocide? And where could you step off that road and make other interventions where that's not the outcome?
Mm-hmm. And if you were to consider who reads your literature, reads your work outside of the academic realm, who might most benefit from your research?
So, I mean, let's start with this. My first book was only read by academics and only reviewed in academic journals, right? The Price of Exclusion, even though I thought it had a lot to offer maybe to thinking about contemporary debates about universalism, multiculturalism, and other kind of, I don't know, discussions in the contemporary world. The second book was read, Living with Hitler, more widely, and a number of people did see the parallels to kind of liberal Democrats or kind of more libertarian conservatives making concessions to authoritarianism in the 2000s. And so I would say it was very useful. I did a Washington Post blog for that book where I talked about those parallels. And you could see people were saying, okay, we can learn from this to understand contemporary world. And then with the last book, which is the only book I've ever written that sold really well, all sorts of audiences find it useful because they recognize themselves, or they recognize the world we live in today and the world I'm describing in Hitler's Monsters, one where there's a return of the repressed in regard to these kind of supernatural, pseudoscientific, illiberal ideas about race and space and what have you. And I think the same audience would find this project attractive because it's looking at the way that problems about border security, immigration, refugees, shifting states and their histories. You look what's going on with the Ukraine right now, how those always will kind of create minorities who are kind of lost in that, in these larger forces, whether it's in, you know, Uyghur in China or Syria or Eastern Europe. And then the question is, how does the international community intervene in that? How do they try to remedy those problems? You can see how messy it is and how difficult it is, and how both the left and the right, if you take the Ukraine crisis, you have people on the left saying, well, we made our bed by antagonizing you know, the former Soviet Union and not following through on NATO, and, you know, it's not worth a world war. And then you got people on the right saying, yeah, exactly, realpolitik, Putin wants a buffer zone. Why would we, right? And then you've got this liberal center saying, no, that's immoral. That's not universalist. People are suffering. This is not a just war. Well, the same conversations were being had when problems were going on with the Jewish community, right? After World War I, many Jews were being murdered by Russians, Poles, and Ukrainians in 1918, 1919 as part of the process of nation building. And people were looking at it already then and saying, what do we do with these Jews, right? How do we take them as refugees? Why did so many East European Jews end up in Germany in the 20s? They were fleeing Eastern Europe. So these are debates that are very relevant to us, whether you're thinking in terms of the experience of the victims and the intellectuals who are members of that community trying to get help. If you think about international law and sovereignty and border security, about national identity and identity building in these so-called nation states, who's a member, who's not, how much capacity does one have to absorb refugees? Take an obvious example. The Germans, very much aware of their own history under Angela Merkel, who is a conservative, mm-hmm. right? Not a socialist, not a liberal, took in 1 million Syrian refugees in a couple years because she felt that was the ethical thing to do given the instability in the Middle East, caused largely by American interventions there, right? The most proximate instability. Obama, despite sharing her views of the world, I think was only able to take in about 8,000 or 10,000 in a country 10 times as large with 3 times the population and a richer, I mean, right? Because of the politics here.
Right, because of the politics, yeah.
Right?
Right.
It wasn't a question of international law or our capacity right. to do it. Right. And then you look at the Jewish question in the 30s. To what degree did wealthy countries, Japan, United States, France,
Great Britain,
where I was, really make an effort to solve this question, as frustrating as it was for them, right, in these ways? To what degree was Germany saying, you know, this might not end well, we don't want all these Jews? You say, well, that's racist. Why would they say it? Well, they're saying it. So there's a problem there, right? Just like in Syria with the refugees, we may not like it. We may say that Assad is a war criminal, but someone at some point has to intervene and do something. Germany did. And I would argue that's linked to their history in the 1930s and 40s, right? Mm-hmm. And we don't feel that level of guilt or responsibility. And therefore we don't interact in the same way with these crises, right? We might throw money at it, but would we absorb 1 million refugees from a non-Western country? So there you go. I think this could.
That's a, we're gonna end that with a ... next episode.
Sure.
So thank you. I really enjoyed this conversation and I appreciate your candor. I hope that this was something that you enjoyed as well on this Monday morning.
I hope so too. Thank you, Harry. And I hope you can see how the research I'm doing and the research getting supported by the summer grant has relevance, as I often think historical research does for the understanding the contemporary world. So thank you.
You're welcome. I like that last statement you made. Historical relevance, contemporary world, I believe. Very good. Well, sir, you have a wonderful day. Take care. Thank you so much, Eric.